Hi there, everybody. My name is Russ Tedrake. I'm a professor here at MIT. I run the Robot Locomotion Group, and we're in this fantastic part of the Stata Center here at MIT. So come on in and let me show you around. The first thing you'll notice is I absolutely love this space. We're in this fantastic area of the building. It looks like a big stainless steel spaceship attached to the back of the building. From the inside, it's just this incredibly inspiring, creative space that we get to fill with robotics. So the Robot Locomotion Group, historically, we worked mostly on legged robots and then a little bit on flying robots. So let me go ahead and show you some of the older robots that we used to work on. This here is Atlas. It was built by Boston Dynamics. It's one of the first versions of the robot that you now see at Boston Dynamics. We got the chance to work with Atlas in the context of the DARPA Robotics Challenge, which was a big competition. We spent a lot of hours on this robot. It's a beautiful robot, we came to love it. It's a hydraulic machine, mostly, and it took a lot of beating and continued to deliver for a long, long time. Unfortunately, it eventually broke and we don't get to use it anymore. But if you look over here, you'll see that the lab was sort of built around the idea of working on these humanoid robots. So we have a big gantry right in the middle of the building here, and Atlas used to hang from the gantry. So when it was walking around, if it did fall, heaven forbid our walking controller wasn't perfect, then it wouldn't do a complete face plant, okay? Right next to Atlas, actually, or right above Atlas here, you'll see we have a 2-meter wingspan robotic bird. This is actually, this was from the 2007 kind of time frame. It was one of the first ever robotic birds, actually. We used to have it flying around campus. It's funny, it used to have a head, a breakaway beak, but it broke away in an accident and hasn't been fixed yet. It's big, it's a 2-meter wingspan machine because back then, the computers that we needed to carry in order to do intelligent control were fairly big. And so we had to have a big enough wing to provide the wing loading, to provide the lift, to carry the big computers. Working on robotic birds got us excited about sort of fundamental questions about dynamics and control. So birds do things that airplanes don't typically do, like land on a perch. And so we started asking, can airplanes do that? Is it a control limitation or is it a mechanical limitation? So we actually have a bunch of perching airplanes around the corner. Let me go show you those. So we had a really fun set of projects a few years ago where we were just trying to build the simplest possible airplane that was capable of landing on a perch like a bird. And it turned out we were able to make them surprisingly simple. So this one here maybe was the simplest of all. It's just a fixed flat plate wing and one controller in the tail. And that airplane, we could fire it out of a cannon and it would still land on a perch like a bird. We used to have fake power lines or strings across the lab and it would go up and stall its wings and land beautifully like a bird. We have other versions of it that have slightly fancier wings. This one even was a flapping wing, flat plate glider that could land on a perch. So we were pretty happy with that. We learned a lot about control, dynamics and control of these very agile maneuvers. And we started to then try to take that outside. So we built these airplanes here, were some of the first computer vision based high speed navigation. So we started to have these airplanes dart through forests at high speeds. It's kind of funny. There's airplane number one and airplane number three here, but airplane number two I think is forever lost in the woods of Western Massachusetts. That was a fateful day and that plane's never coming back. We spent a long time. We even sent another drone in looking for the first one, but it's never to be found. Good, so let me show you some of the other robots on the other side of the lab. Okay, so even though we still call ourselves the Robot Locomotion Group, I'm attached to the name and unlikely to change it, but these days we actually spend a lot of time working on robots with hands, doing robotic manipulation. So you'll see a lot of robotic arms and some more dexterous hands, and we're trying to apply our core understanding of dynamics and control to the problem of manipulation. fact, if you come around here, you'll see there's a lot of robotic arms around the corner. So Tommy and Shruti over here are working on some bimanual manipulation. They're gonna tell you a little bit more about that later. You'll see some other robotic arms over here. Hidden behind the curtain, there's another set of robotic arms that are doing some tool use tasks. So I still love legged robots, but these days I'm mostly working on robot manipulation. And the reason for that is pretty specific. So right around the time we finished up on this project, working on the humanoid, that was the beginning of the deep learning revolution. And computer vision started to really start to work. Now, when you're a legged robot, then you need to use your cameras to see the world and understand where you're allowed to step. But if you're a robot with hands that needs to, I don't know, prepare a salad or make a pizza, then the understanding that you have to have with your cameras of the things that you're about to manipulate in the world is so much more sophisticated. Okay, so it really wasn't until computer vision started working really well that we could even imagine doing the more interesting things with our robotic hands. So you'll see that the lab is really trying to work now on the fundamental questions about bringing our expertise in dynamics and control into the world of robotic manipulation. Now there's two big approaches that we're taking to that. One of it is based really on core machine learning. So even for the control systems, we're trying to use machine learning to control and understanding some of the theory of how some of the new ideas from generative AI should be applied to manipulation. But we're also continuing to work on optimization-based, model-based, structured optimization in order to do really, really good control with our hands. And in fact, we've had a bit of a revolution in the lab these days with a new set of algorithms that are the best algorithms we've ever had for planning motions with complicated contact interactions for our interesting robots. So I'm really excited for you to hear a little bit more about that from some of the students. The students here are amazing. It's just a joy to work with them every day. And so I want you to hear from them.